You know, it's interesting with a new early signing period in December, it allows us to be at so much further ahead than we would normally do at other times. And when we met this past December, we talked about it and how it affected us and was it a good thing for us in our recruiting class. And at that time, I stated I thought it was. I thought it was very helpful for us because of our ability in early identification, our ability to then evaluate those players and begin to develop a relationship that will put us in position to be able to sign some of these young men. The names we talked about at the back end was Spencer Burford, and what a talent that he was and what he brought to the table. And the final rankings and come out in his, you look at 24/7 ratings for the worth of it, and he becomes our first four-star high school signee. We've had other guys that were transfers that were rated as high or higher coming out of high school, but came here by way of junior college. He was the first guy that actually, from a high school rank, is the highest recruit ever in the history of our program right here in San Antonio from Wagner High School. And so we're very fortunate to be able to land him. You take December signing period out of it, and he's a four-star prospect, one of the top 25 off top 50 offensive linemen in America, and it's a little more challenging for us to finish with him. But at the time when we started recruiting him, he wasn't as highly touted as some may have thought he was. We thought differently. We trust our evaluation. We went forth and moved with him, and he continued to go on and have an outstanding senior season and has done some really good things outside of that in the postseason as well in all-star games. And so we're excited about Spencer as he leads our class. The next young man, he's actually with us already, is Cordell Gundy, a quarterback from Northeast Oklahoma Community College. Probably a little undersized coming out of high school, continued to develop. Really had an outstanding freshman year as quarterback at NEO. Came back this year, played consistent when he was in, got nicked a little bit and was in and out. But, you know, was considering Memphis. We got into it, a tussle with them for his, you know, to get him to come to our university. And we were able to win at the end. And we think he brings more competition to the room, in a room that's talented but yet very youthful talent there. And it's a wide open race for our quarterback position. There is no declared starter or incumbent. So we're looking forward to fostering healthy competition at the quarterback position. We don't have a starter, and so our intent at this point isn't to redshirt anybody, but to allow these guys to go out in spring football and be live and compete and see guys who can make throws under duress, guys that can take a shot and get up and keep on ticking, guys that have all the things that we believe make up being a great leader at the quarterback position with the toughness and zeal that we're looking for. And so in our scrimmage formats and this spring, our quarterbacks will be live and we'll find out who we are.
How big of a get is Brendan Brady?
Yeah, a tremendous get for us. You know, when I got into the home, I said to his parents, I know we may have appeared to be a nuisance because we fought for your son, but we did so because he was worth fighting for. He's in our backyard, and we were not about to lay down and let him walk out here and go to Rice, SMU, or anywhere else, that we were going to put our best foot forward. And anything that's worth something is worth fighting for. And I hope you respect that and understand the message that we were trying to convey to you guys. And certainly they did, because as evident, it paid its dividends for us, and we were able to land him. But he's a tremendous prospect for us that is very talented. You know, he had all type of bites, you know, whether it was Vanderbilt, Northwestern, all over the country, because he's a high academic student as well. But we were able to show them, and the thing that helped with Brendan was that the football program itself wasn't enough. That we really relied on UTSA We really relied on the city of San Antonio and was able to paint a picture to him, to his parents, what it meant to run out of that tunnel in the Alamo Dome, to see your son wrapped around that building with his jersey on it, that this is his city. So Tyke is interesting. He was a Tennessee Player of the Year, an outstanding talent, as we know, as a junior, and was recruited by everybody in the country. We were able to maneuver through some things that had hindered him from being all that he can be as a senior. Visit with his coach, visit with his parents, got them on our campus, went into their home, and really entrenched ourselves with uncle, mom, Nana, everybody, mailman, barbershop, and really got to know the young man better. Best. He's on our campus right now, and we had an academic meeting on yesterday, and here's what our academic support staff said. He's a joy. He works extremely hard. He's diligent. He's accountable. He's on time. Coach, we're so excited to have him here. And you look at the company that he keeps, and when it's amazing when you put someone in an environment that's conducive, how they'll blossom. And we were able to give him that opportunity. And the thing that we got to constantly realize is that at an institution of higher learning, that we change lives, we shape lives, and in some cases, we even save lives. You know, it'll really resonate 4 years from now at the back end of these young men's career when we see the success that we've had as a program. You see the success that they'll have with opportunities to extend their playing careers, and you'll go back and reflect and then say, wow, that's the class we had. And so I was at a school years ago, and you had a young man named Patrick Willis from Brewston, Tennessee, and Dexter McCluster from Largo, Florida, Mike Wallace from New Orleans, and nobody ever heard of him. And then just so happened, these guys become first and second round draft picks and all pros, and it was the 30th ranked class in the country, 30th. All right, Michael Orr's and all the other ones. And so what's going to happen here is 4 years from now, 5 years from now, if we're able to continue the development, because the recruiting is one part of it, then the development is the next, and have the success in the classroom, on the field, and then beyond, we'll really
see. Frank, this is the first time we talked to you since you hired Al Borges as your offensive coordinator.
Yeah.
Can you give us an idea of how much the offense will change, or what can you tell us about the style of offense?
Can I keep it to the vest just so we can have an element of surprise if people don't prepare for us
a little bit
all summer? Okay, so he's done it all in his 30-plus years. He's groomed them all, whether it's Jason Campbell and Ronnie and Cadillac or Kay McNown and those guys at UCLA, or resurrecting a San Jose program or San Diego State and a West Coast spread, pro style, you name it. Going to Michigan in year one and winning 11, 12 games, whatever it is, whatever they won with a Denard Robinson who is not viewed as a drop back prototype guy, whatever it is, the thing that's been consistent with L. Borges is that he's had an uncanny ability, unlike others, to be able to adapt to the talent and maximize the talent that we have. And that's what we're seeking. We're seeking to recognize this is what we have. Regardless of what schematically we would like to do, let's do what's best for the talent that we've surrounded ourselves with to give ourselves the best chance to be successful on the football field. He does that as well as anyone in the country, and has done so consistently wherever he has been. So we're excited about Al and what he brings to the table. And I can tell you this, from a schematic standpoint, we will be an offense that is talent-driven, not schematic-driven. So based on our talent, our schemes will come off of it, not just a scheme to have in place to say we're doing one thing or another.